Jesus. Lord, we lift up your name in this place, thanking you that we are new creations in Christ, that we are free to worship you, Lord, that the chains have been broken, and that we live in a place where we can honor your name, Jesus.
That be in Christ is a new creature.
Sing praise.
Stone.
Hallelujah.
Unless the Lord builds the house, they that build it in vain. I'm so thankful that we are built on the solid rock of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. God, we honor you. Hallelujah. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest rain, but wholly trust in Jesus' name, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same.
Christ. in the Savior's love.
To move mountains, Lord, that you're able to move hearts and change lives, Lord. It's not just something we say, it's who you are. I'm so thankful that you're awesome, God, that you're worthy, God, that you alone deserve the praise, the honor, and the glory in our hearts, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus, we just lift you up.
Come on, sing it now together. Give the Lord a big hand clap of praise.
You're an awesome God.
Hallelujah.
Glory to your name, Jesus.
Hallelujah. He's mighty. Hallelujah. He's mighty. He's awesome. Come on. Let's sing it together. He's mighty.
He's mighty.
He's mighty. We need to sing it together as a congregation. Come on.
He's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty.
Come on.
He's mighty. Awesome. Yes, he is. Awesome.
Come on. He's mighty. Come on.
He's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty.
Talking about our God. Amen. Give the Lord,
Lord Jesus, you alone are worthy.
Hallelujah.
We love you, Lord.
Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we love you, Jesus.
We bless him in this place.
Lord.
We serve a mighty God.
Yes,
amen.
He
can do great and mighty things
Glory
in your life and our life. Lord, we bless you. We just come on. Everybody together. Come on. Let's just worship him a moment.
Yes.
Father, we bless you right now. Come on, everybody. We just love you, Lord Jesus, in this place.
I love you, Lord.
We bless you, God, and we glorify you. Lord, we want to exalt you as the great and mighty God that can do great and mighty things, Lord God. And Father, I pray that you help us always to know that in our hearts, deep in our hearts, Lord God. We bless you. We love you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. One more time. Give the Lord a big hand clap of praise. All right. Thank you, guys. Good job. Awesome. We like seeing these young people do some awesome things for the kingdom of God. Amen. If our God is for us, who can be against us? Hey, Jonathan, come see right quick, son. Where you at? Tell me right quick. You know, you did the drama and everything, but what does that mean? Can you tell me what that means to us? I mean, what does that mean?
Well, no matter what's going on in your life, God got your back. He'll never let you down. If our God is with us, then what could stand against? I mean, come on. That's all it is to it.
Hallelujah. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. Come on, man. He got your back. Hallelujah. Over the past, really, 20 weeks, we've been discussing the topic, don't fight naked. And we've been discussing how it's imperative that we put on the armor of God. And we discussed the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit. We've discussed the shoes shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And we've discussed all those things. And he said, I want you to put these things on because the enemy is going to try to throw fiery darts at you. And if you remember right how I told you what that fiery dart was not only a thing that they could shoot at you, but it had a... History tells us that it had almost like a gasoline in it. That way when it hit people or hit its shields, it would explode. And we discussed a little bit of how when that explodes, the enemy is trying to awaken all of our lust and desires. So when the enemy shoots that fiery dart into our heart and mind, if we don't have the armor of God, he is going to try to arouse all of those desires that are within us. Now, a lot of people, we are a new creation in Christ Jesus. I know that. I am a new creation in Christ Jesus in the fact that I don't have to follow after those things any longer. Before, I would have just done it. But the reality is that is there. And the Lord has provided many tools. He's provided the armor of God. And you can go back to YouTube if you want to look and study some of that there. But he's provided the armor of God. And he has provided something else for us. Now, it has been... I've been in the ministry going on 28 years now, if not longer. I don't remember exactly. I stopped count for a while back. But anyway, going right on 30 years. I've seen a lot of things come and go. I've seen a lot of experiences come and go. I've seen people laugh and roll in the floor. I've seen people shake. I've seen and I've seen people sit there like a knot on the log. I've seen just about anything and everything that goes on. And I've always tried to be a person who compares whatever is going on to Scripture. What does the Scripture say about what the experiencer people are going through? As a kid coming up, I was taught about tongues, that tongues was nothing more, listen to me, wasn't nothing more a bunch of people getting into an emotional trance and babbling things off. I was taught that type of things, and it kind of confused me because when I read in the Scripture, I read stuff like, when he that speaketh in unknown tongues edifies himself. So a person that was full of a bunch of lust and was messed up, I had enough sense to recognize that I needed edifying. I'm just saying y'all might be perfect out of your mother's womb. I don't know. But me, I was a pretty messed up joker. And I was at least willing to talk about it. You know, we'd be in Sunday school classroom at Cooper Baptist Church, you know, and we'd be talking about it. And I'd just talk about it. They knew it, so why let's discuss it? And when I would make mention to me, they'd tell me stuff like, well, maybe you need to go to another church if you want more. And that just kind of confused me, you know, as a young man. And but to make a long story short, God in his grace always kept me. And he's helped me through life. And I want to discuss some things here this morning. We want to look at Scripture. I am not trying to teach something here to confuse you. I'm not trying to teach something here to make you think you're more spiritual, look more spiritual. I'm trying to help you, give you a tool to be able to deal with the emotional things we have to deal with in life. We just got to deal with them, don't we? Religion can't keep you from the issues in life that you're going to have to face. That is a lie. We got to face things, and we got to face them tough. And thank God we got His Word, and we got things in His Word that He tells us that helps us in everyday life. Have you ever been in a situation that the answer for peace in your life was beyond your human ability? A place where it seemed that the dark cloud of depression seemed to hover over you and hopelessness was setting in. Have you ever been in that place? Have you ever been in a situation that your natural talents and abilities could not help you? Maybe one of your children was facing something that was about beyond your ability to help. Your child diagnosed with a disease and they're telling you that she got a very slight chance of making it through this, and maybe her kidneys will be gone, and they're looking at transplants, and they're looking at me because I'm probably a transplant. I've been there. I've been there where, my Lord, what do? You're quoting scriptures, and hallelujah, I know about praying in the Holy Ghost. And praying in the Holy Ghost and doing all those different things. Brother D's been there. I've been in situations where I don't know how to handle myself. When people accusing you of stuff and saying stuff to you that in the natural, you want to go pop them in the eyeball. You know what I'm saying? You want to show, I'm going to tell you something, and punch them right in the eye. But you know down deep, that will settle nothing. God has tools to help us out in those situations. Have you ever had a burden for someone but couldn't figure out exactly what it was or what to do? Have you seen people around you facing things and are facing depressions and facing situations, and in the natural you don't know what to say to help them? Let me tell you something. God gives us something that bypasses our intellect and our not knowing how to help us through those situations. Have you ever been in a place where you needed direction and it seemed like the human counsel did not bring any peace? You went to this person, say, what should I do? And they, well, I think you ought to do this. And when they told you, you walked away and you're like, I'm not sure about that. And you may went to mom and daddy for help and their counsel fell short. God gives us something, guys. He gives us His Word, and He gives us, I'm just going to go on and speak about it, a prayer language that He gives you, that He prays through you in groanings and utterances. You don't know what it's about. And we're going to talk about this, and we're going to discuss this. And I've tried to lay it out for the past couple weeks. It's not something to be ashamed of. It's not something secret. It's not something that's going to jump on you and shake you and make you do something. It is simply a prayer language that God gives you to help you. And if you would open up your heart to see what the scripture teaches, and hell, I'm going to try to help you a little bit more. I want to slightly help you see the difference between, and this is where people's messed up, okay? There's a difference between tongues and interpretation of tongues, and then tongues as in a private prayer language. You see that in 1 Corinthians 14. Okay? And today we're going to discuss a little bit that private prayer language. Without embarrassing people who do or do not. How many in here have that private prayer language? Pretty awesome, ain't it? Not that they're any more spiritual than a person that doesn't. It's kind of like, this is what I say to people all the time. It's like the difference between building a house with an old frame and hammer. You can build the house, can't you? But it's so much easier when you got that nail gun. Tiki, 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 tiki. You see what I'm saying? The same byproduct is going to take place. The house is going to get built. But sometimes it's a little bit easier when you got tools to help us out. And let me tell you something. You have tools at your disposal that you haven't been told of, or you've been told it's wrong. And Brother Damon's here to tell you that God knew it from the beginning what He had for you. Amen. Let's look at the scripture right quick. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, starting with verse 15. Chapter 14 started with verse 15. God has the answer for you through those tough times. It's nothing you got to be embarrassed of. You got to be ashamed of. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 15. What is it then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the Spirit also. Let's pray. Father, we bless You. Father, I pray that this morning that you would just open our ears to hear. I pray that you open up our eyes of our understanding that we might be enlightened to see the scripture. Father, I thank you that we don't have to be afraid of what your word says. We bless you. We ask you to now just anoint us, make it easy to learn, easy to speak. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. What is it then? He says two things here. I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding. Let's go and see what praying with the understanding means, and then we could find out maybe a little bit what it means to pray in the spirit, okay? The word with there means in kinship, empathy, some kind of connection, association, or fellowship. So God is saying there is a kinship, there is association that you can have in your own understanding. Okay, the word understanding there means the mind, the intellectual faculty, and understanding. Everybody here has the ability, if you're a born-again child of God, you have the ability to pray what we all know, what God has revealed to us in the Scripture. God has revealed certain things in the Scripture, and I've talked about them over the past couple of weeks. We got the spirit of prayer of agreement, the prayer of, I showed you all kinds of different things about prayer. God says, I will pray with the understanding. That means in association with what God's Word tells us we can pray for. He said, I pray that me and my household shall be what? Saved. I pray for healing. We pray for folks that are sick. We pray for all these different things, for deliverance. He says, I will pray for those things, and I will pray with my understanding and my intellect, because I know that's what's in the Word of God. And then he says, I will pray with the Spirit. The word again with the Spirit is in kinship or association with the Spirit. Now, a lot of people try to teach you and tell you that you praying over here and the Holy Spirit telling you what to go pray, therefore you go pray. Well, why do you got to go pray for something if he's bringing it up in your intellectual and your understanding? Okay, let's look at the word spirit there. It means various modes. It's where we get the Greek word pneumas or the Hebrew word ruach, okay? It's when the Holy Spirit breathes upon the individual and gives them ability to pray something. So he says, I will pray in the spirit. I will pray in my mind and intellect what I know according to the word. And he said, I will pray in the spirit. God breathe upon me and give me a language to be able to pray there. And you say, I don't know if that's what's, I don't, well, you said language here. We're fixing to get to that here and help you understand something, okay? Let's keep on going here. Praying with the spirit then, listen to me right here. Praying with my understanding is God giving me the ability to pray what I know is in the written word of God. Praying in the spirit is when the Holy Spirit falls in and helps us bear the weaknesses in things not obvious to our understanding or hidden counsel of God. It's when the Holy Spirit, and we're going to get to a little bit understanding that in a little bit. Praying in the spirit is when the Holy Spirit falls in with our praying. In our weaknesses, areas that we don't know how we should pray. When depressions and stuff start trying to come on us. When I'm praying for individuals and I do not know what to pray for them, the Holy Spirit comes in and falls in line with us. And begins to pray through us in groanings and utterances that I don't know what they're about. In fact, 1 Corinthians 14 says, when we pray in tongues, we speak mysteries. And I was a fun when I began to study out and see what that word mysteries there means, alrighty? And let's look at, so praying in the natural, y'all got me, is when I'm praying what I know is in the Word of God, I intellectually know what's going on. So we got that, right? We understand that. In other words, if a person comes to you and says, I'm sick, will you pray for me? It is not hard for me to know what to do. We can say, Father, I thank you that your word says intellectually, I know according to your scripture, by your stripes we are here.
Father, I know according to Mark chapter 15 or 16, the Bible says, you shall lay on the hands on the sick and they shall do what? Recover. Lord, your word says according to James, if anyone is sick in him body, let him call forth the elders, letting them put anointing him with oil, and the prayer of sick will raise them up. So Lord, I know intellectually this what goes on. But what happens when you're dealing with situation that you pray for them and things are not happening and you don't understand what's going on? God's got something for you. Let me give you a quick reference. Let's run to 1 Corinthians 14. This is just a little side note before we go into a little bit further. 1 Corinthians 14 says, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto who? If you don't mind, leave it there, okay? When God gives me a prayer language to pray, or pray in tongues, God has given me an ability to pray and speak to God. See, tongues and interpretation is your ability to speak to what? Man. One is for you to speak to God. Tongues and interpretation is for you to do what? Speak unto man. Let's go to read that in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 21 and 22. Let's read that and see what it says. For one is talking about a prayer language. This is talking about tongues and interpretation of tongues. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto these people. This is God speaking to people. Tongues and interpretation is when God wants to say something to people. Prayer language is when I want to speak to God. And yet, for all that, they will not hear me, saith the Lord. Said another scripture. Wherefore, tongues are for a sign, not unto them that what? Believe. Tongues and interpretation is not for them that believe, but to them that believeth not. See, tongues and an interpretation, and tongues with half the world's afraid to do, it's not for the believer, it's for the unbeliever. Well, I don't know if I want all that. Well, it don't really matter if you want all that. What matters is what the word says. But prophesying serveth not for them that believe not, but for they which believe. If you want to speak to those that believe, we prophesy to them. In tongues and interpretation is the same as prophecy, okay? Just a little side note there. So tongues is me speaking to God. Tongues and interpretation of tongues is God speaking to man. Got it? Let me say that again. When I pray in tongues, I'm saying Damon. When Damon Plummer prays in his prayer language, that is me and God communicating back and forth. When there's a tongues and interpretation in the church out loud, that is God wanting to speak to mankind. In fact, the scripture goes on to say they're revealing the secrets and hearts and intent of man. Now, let's go to Romans chapter 8 and let's look at something. 26 through 28. This passage of scripture is talking about the prayer language here. Now, this ain't something I just pull up out of the scripture. This is something I've studied, and I've studied men of God who studied these passages of scripture. I ain't wanting to twist it. I'm wanting to help you understand something. Verse 26, 8:20 says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our what? Infirmities. For when we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings and which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for the good of them who love God and to them who are called according to the purpose of God. Real quickly, everybody always quotes that scripture, all things work together for the good of them who love God and who are the called according to his purpose. But that passage is specifically talking when the Spirit of God intercedes with you and knows what your heart and mind is. God takes what's going on in your heart and mind. He brings the Holy Spirit along to pray beside of us, and he rescues us from what's going on in our heart and mind and praise through us the will of God. Now that's a side note. Let's get back to find out what's going on here. It says that likewise the Spirit also helpeth what? Our infirmities. What does the helpeth there mean? The word helpeth there means to lay hold along with, to strive to obtain with others, helping in obtaining. The Holy Spirit, God, comes along the side of us and helps us obtain something. When you're having infirmities and when we're not knowing exactly what needs to go on, God comes along and helps us what in our infirmities. What does the word infirmities mean? The word infirmity means to bear trials and troubles, the mental state in which the weakness manifests. Now, you're talking about when you're struggling with issues, struggling with sin. Thank God, hallelujah, that the cross took care of that issue, but I don't always are able to do it. So God helps me. He comes along and undergirds me and helps me obtain what God has already done for me when I am mentally weak and can't. God can come on and I can pray in a language that I may not know what's going on with my wife. I can see something a little bit different. Maybe she's struggling. I remember when she was going through her migraines and she would stay there vomiting in the hospital because the migraines were so bad. I was helpless. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't help her. But hallelujah, the Spirit of God comes and gives you a prayer language that you can pray, and the Holy Spirit prays through us in groanings and utterance. Y'all hang on with me. I'm trying to lay a passage of scripture down. Help us understand, okay, some things. Okay? 2 Corinthians 11, 24 through 30 gives us a little example of this. Okay? Let's look at 24 says. Now look at this. This is the Apostle Paul. We want to look at what infirmities means here. Of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Five different times the man was beat 39 times. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck a night and day. In other words, he floated around on a log for a night and day. I have been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of water, perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the weakness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watching often, in hunger and in thirst, and in fasting often, in coldness and nakedness. Beside those things that are without, that's things on the outside. That which cometh to me daily, look what he said. Beside those things which are on the outside, that which cometh upon me daily, the care for all the churches. Who is weak, and I am not weak. Who is offended, and I'm burnt not. If I must needs glory, I will glory only in the things which concern what? My infirmities. What does he say? Confirmities are these things that he couldn't do nothing about in his natural ability. He could pray about it and talk about it. Come on, I'm floating out on the water out there. Lord, I know it's your will for me to get off of this water. Well, I ain't off of it so right now, so guess what? I can begin to pray in the Spirit and maybe the sharks won't get me. Okay, just it was a little side note. But look what he saw. An infirmity is something that was with past your intellectual capacity to be able to deal with it. Now, come on, don't y'all face those things? Don't you ever just dealing with your children and not for sure what? You know, what do you say to them? They're 25 years old. They're 22 years old. What I said to them as a kid, you can't say to them necessarily as they become an adult. What do you say to people when they're about to leave their husbands or their wives? What do you say to them? Let's go back to 1 Corinthians 8, 26 through 30. So we see there the infirmities are things that just are without, out of your control. Thank God he helpeth us in our infirmities. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings and groanings which cannot be uttered. Now look at this. The Holy Spirit, look what it says. Who is coming to make intercession for us? According to the scripture here. Look at it. For he said, we should be back at, we still should be at 26. We're at 26. Go back to 26. But the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be what? Be uttered. Hang that right there. The Spirit himself that lives within you comes along the side with you and begins to intercede through who? Through you. Now the word maketh intercession there means to fall in on the behalf of someone else or to rescue. If a person has fallen into a cave, you must go down in there or drop something down in there to help rescue them. The Bible says the Spirit of God, when you are in your weaknesses or your infirmities, or when life is out of control with you, or you're feeling depression come upon you. There's more depression in Mississippi than anything I've ever seen. And God's got the tool and the answer for them. But the traditional church says it's of the devil. God's got something on you when you're destroyed. I mean, you're inside spiritually, you're distraught. He's got something for you when you're beginning to be discouraged. The Bible says the Spirit of God will fall right in beside you and rescue you up out of the pit that you're finding yourself in. The Holy Spirit supernaturally joins into our circumstances and shares our emotions and our frustrations. He, the Spirit, begins to work a plan out to rescue us. And we more worried about our kids getting their high school diploma and going to college than we are helping them understand the number one thing that can come in and help them and all. Or, well, just imagine if when people begin to pick on your kids and they're walking down the hallway and nobody around underneath their breath, they're saying, I don't know what to say. Lord, they're hurting my heart. They're putting me down. I ain't got clothes like they got. I ain't got a mom and daddy like they got. But you know what? That's beyond my ability. I can't help that. And I'm not going to sit here and get depressed over stuff that I can't fix. But hallelujah, I pray that the Holy Ghost would come along the side of me, undergird me and rescue me, because emotionally right now I am distraught. So Holy Spirit of God, help me and give me understanding in the midst of this where I can make it. You tell me why people would not want that. Why would people reject what the Holy Spirit of God? It's because they're ignorant of the truth. And Brother D is here. I ain't trying to yell at you. I ain't trying to scream at you. I'm gently trying to tell you what the scripture says. You can choose to get on with it or you can choose to ignore it, whatever you want. But I promise you, in the long run, you're going to regret not saying, Lord, I want what that has for me. Because in this old world, we got to deal with issues. You can stay locked in behind your four walls if you want to, but D's out there in the midst of it. I'm struggling with kids just stressing out over will they hit the ball or not hit the ball. We're dealing with issues and folks with people ready to take their life in front of us. My Lord, have mercy. We are to be able to pray for them and be able to intercede for them like never before. I thank God. The Holy Spirit has come and fell along the side of me so many times. Raising my girls. Pastoring the church, not wanting to hurt people. Not wanting to say things that are incorrect. Accuse you of being prejudiced. accuse you of stuff. You want to go out there and fix it with your own understanding. But you know what? Hallelujah for the Holy Ghost. He comes along the side of me, and I don't do this often, and I ain't trying to impress you, but I'm telling you, there's time when the Holy Spirit comes on me, and I'm by myself. I'm driving down the road, and just internal. I do it most of the time, and I pray in tongues now more underneath my breath, just me and myself. He comes along and begins to rescue you mentally, where you're mentally about to throw in the towel. Young people, I know some of you have been baptized in the Holy Ghost, speaking tongues. You've only done it once. But the Bible, listen to me, as I begin to pray, the Holy Spirit falls in line with me and prays through me with groanings and utterance. I don't know. You get that? I begin to pray. As he gives me the utterance, the scripture says, he comes along and sides with me and pray. You ain't got to be ashamed of it. Now, if you're getting going through the halls of your school and you speaking in tongues and everybody looking at you like you're ignorant, Paul gives the scripture not to do that. And that's what he's talking about. It'd be like me standing up here and speaking in tongues and preaching at y'all. You'd be like, the man is mad. He said, if you're going to do that in the church, you got to speak in tongues and give an interpretation in tongues. Y'all hang on with me. And check this out. Verse 27, Romans, bro, 8:27. Check this out. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit. Look what he says. He who knows searches the heart, and he that knows the mind of the Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit knows what's going on in your emotions. That's your heart, the seat of your passions and desires. And he that knows the mind of the Spirit. He makes those two because he make intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Look what he says. Go on to verse 28. And I've already said this one time. And we know that all things work together for the good of them who love God and to them who are called according to his purpose. God knows my heart. And he knows the mind of the Spirit. And when I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, God begins to work his will out in my life. When you don't, what I do? You know what I do? You know how it is, being a single mom. How do you do it? Give your kids the best. How do you do it? Do you tell them your dad was okay when down deep you hate them? Do you look at your mom and daddy in their face and, you know, they left you and dumped you on the side of the road when you was a kid? And I deal with that here with people. Do you look at them or when you got to go visit them and be all smiley? Hey, mom and dad, how are you? You know what? Hallelujah. You can pray in the Holy Ghost on the way there and he can keep you calm where you won't have to punch them out when you get there. You see what I'm getting at? The Holy Spirit does things for us more than just me speaking in Babel language. Guys. The Holy Spirit of God comes in and he prays with me and deals with me. He comes along the side of me and begins to rescue me from my emotional basket case when I'm fixing to want to do something I shouldn't do. Why would a person not want that is beyond my comprehension. Let me tell you something, D. It happened to Brother Damon close to 30 years ago. And you're talking about a joker that was messed up emotionally. Laying in my bed at night wondering what is going on with me. I'm doing the things I don't want to do, and I'm doing the very things I don't want to do. Well, what a wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death. That's what I was struggling with and dealing with. See, there it makes all things work together. The word work together means a fellow worker or a helper. To work with, sharing with the work. He who knows the mind and knows the heart of man falls in line and begins to work together with you. When you couldn't do it on your own, guess what he does? Praying in the Holy Spirit, he begins to work with you. And you begin to say, you're right, Lord, I shouldn't do these things. And you're sitting there praying, and you're wanting to be angry, and they hurt your kid, and they did this stuff, and you're wanting to do that. And the Holy Ghost is coming along the side in. You know what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit's working with you, come along and works with you, and helps you through these things. And by the way, for everybody, I don't believe in all that. There's over 500 million folks that speak in tongues. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Excuse me, chapter 14, verse 2. And let's go look at that again and see what some scripture says. See, I'm not trying to, I don't want to prove to you, but I don't want us to be ignorant. You got it? I'm tired of trying to have to prove stuff to people. But on the flip side, I don't want us to be ignorant. I want you to know what the scripture says. That way when some religious person tries to tell you you're wrong, you can have enough sense to tell them back. First Corinthians 14, 2 said, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit he speaketh mysteries. What does the word mystery believe mean? Put that up there for me. It's pretty cool how all this works out. Brother D couldn't come up with it. I don't even know half of these words. Mysteries, a hidden secret or thing, not obvious to the understanding, a hidden purpose or counsel, secret will. When I'm praying in tongue, I'm learning, God's speaking through me the secret thing that is not obvious to my mind. The Holy Spirit's praying through me the will of God. I may not want to be lining up on the will of God, but the Holy Spirit is praying through me, and it's helping me emotionally begin to line up with the will of God. Well, when you speak in tongues, you're supposed to have an interpreter. That ain't what that scripture said. He says, when I speak in tongues there, I'm speaking unto men, and I'm speaking what? Mysteries. In other words, my understanding is unfruitful. The reason it's unfruitful, because you ain't getting it in the first place, so I got to pray in tongues through you to help you in the midst of this and come along and rescue you. Let's look at this right here, 1 Corinthians 14, 3 through 4. Let's look at it. But he that prophesies speaketh unto men to edification, exhortation, and comfort. If a person stands up in this pulpit and prophesies over you or over this church, listen to me. And there's a lot of Pentecostals don't like this. But look what he says here. Look what he says here. Speaketh, when a person prophesies, speaketh unto men for what? Edification, exhortation, and comfort. Not to try to find some secret sin in your life. And if he's a prophet trying to find some secret sin in your life, I will stand up on the platform and put him out. Ask people, I have done it. I was in a church service one time with this young charismatic guru, and he had all that, and he was from Dallas, Texas, and I was a youth pastor, and he was blowing on people. I guess he thought he was going to pull a Benny Hinn, and he was blowing on. Then when they wouldn't fall, he'd back up and get him another deep breath. And I'm standing over on the side, and Barry's the pastor time, and I'm like, this is crazy. This is crazy. This is crazy. This is crazy. And I'm standing up right beside him like, I ain't trying to be arrogant. I'm just like, come on, dude. Look. Again, I've told you in stories, I've been in the whole sanctuary when everybody's falling out in the spirit, laid out on the floor supposedly, and I'm the only one standing still. Like, oh my God, I'm the most unspiritual person in this whole place. I'm like, I told you I gave him a free fall one time, huh? I went back the next night, and everybody was slain again, supposedly. And I'm like, oh, God, you know, here I am. So I said, I'll tell you what I do. I do a lot of things in faith, so I'm fixing to fall in faith. When that dude prays for me, I'm just going to see how it does in faith. I'm willing to try in faith, Lord. He had got some of that oil. By the way, his name was Jack Daniels. That's truly, his name was Jack Daniels. He's from up in the mountains in Kentucky. He took that bottle of oil and put it on me, and he looked at me, and I was probably judging. I'm thinking, he's thinking I'm so unspiritual, because I was wearing polyester pants back then. And they had blue jeans stuff. He come walking to me. He put his hands on me with oil dripping down my face. I had long curly hair back then too. Messed my hair up. What is he thinking? No, but anyway, he prays for me. So I fall on purpose. Boom! Now I'm laying on the floor thinking, this is so retarded. Am I against being slain in the spirit? No. The scripture says as Peter walked by them, his shadow fell on them and they fell as dead men. I could show you scripture for that, so I'm not against it. Just for Brother D, it was a free fall because I almost busted my head out. Ben, on the other hand, first time he was ever in a Pentecostal service or with a lady, she prophesied and laid hands on him. He fell out. And he said, I don't even know if I was saved in or not. All I know is I got up and didn't know what was going on. I said, well, I guess you're more spiritual than I am, Ben. So, y'all ain't listening right here. But you got that scripture back up, verse 4. But he that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself, but he that prophesies edifies the church. Look what he says there. He says, when I speak in an unknown tongue, he already told me it's mysteries. He said, when I speak in an unknown tongue, I'm edifying myself. Now, what does the word edify there mean? And we're getting ready to close out, okay? You got the word edify there, bro? Don't have it? There you go. Edify, to restore by building, to rebuild or repair. This is not Brother D. Listen to me. When you're emotionally shipwrecked, the enemy's throwing fiery darts at the enemy, and they're exploding, and things are going on all around you. The Bible says when you pray in an unknown tongue, he begins to rebuild. He begins to come in here and say, Lord God, in a sense, begin to reestablish the heart and mind. He'll bring scriptures up to you. You'll be praying in tongues, and all of a sudden you'll begin to remember, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Hallelujah. You'll be praying in tongues, and all of a sudden the scripture rises up, with God all things are possible. And what is he doing? He's building. Guess what he's doing? He's building your faith. And we're going to see that in Jude 20 here. What is he doing? He's building your faith. And Brother D ain't trying to pull something on you. It's crazy. I'm not trying to get you to do something. I'm just letting you know. I've been around long enough, and I'm a realist when it comes to the Word of God. I'm not some spiritual guru waiting for anything new that comes along. I've been in the Word of God, studying the Word of God, and where I've been wrong, I have pulled back and said I was wrong. But God gives us something to come in and rebuild us in life instead of everything being so intellectual. Let's go to Jude, starting with verse 17, and we're getting to close out on this. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you that there should be mockers in the last times, who should walk after their own ungodly lust. These by they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. But you, beloved, building up yourself on your most holy faith, praying, not in your own understanding, praying in the Holy Ghost. And I could show you more scriptures in the Spirit stuff. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Look what he says. Keep yourself in love in God, looking for the mercy of God of our Lord Jesus Christ unto the early. When I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, I'm doing what? I'm keeping myself. Now look at that. That word, That word building up yourself is the same scripture for edifying. What did I say edifying was? Building up yourself. When I'm praying in the Holy Ghost, I'm building up myself. See, there are a lot of people who are afraid to talk about the things, and some are embarrassed for people to know that they pray in tongues. It is because the church has been uninformed about the things of the Spirit, and many of them have made the choice to stay ignorant about these things. The private prayer language is the singular most powerful weapon given to the believer other than the Word of God. It's real simple. I've spoke 3 different weeks on the different things about the Holy Spirit of God. I hope I've educated you in a sense that way when people begin to try to tell you that what you're doing is crazy. I hope that you got enough scripture that I've talked to you over the past 3 weeks. You can at least tell yourself, well, I ain't going to argue with them, but I know difference. Go on Hosanna-Pope on YouTube, and you'll see what I've talked about, different things about praying in tongues and stuff like that. But listen to me. God gives us a prayer language to pray. It's already in you, by the way. You say, I don't know. It's in you. God has already put the utterance of tongues within you. The utterance is there. Utterance means the words. I must speak the words. That's tongues. I must speak in your tongue. Always try to speak without your tongue moving. Put your tongue on the roof of your mouth and say, hi, Damon.
Hey, Amy.
I ain't trying to be funny. I'm just trying to be, it's not that easy. God, listen to me. If you never speak in tongues, it ain't that big of a deal to me. I'll be your friend. I love you. But I'm just telling you, God gives us a prayer language where he falls along the side of me and he helps me. You hear me? He rescues me from the mental path or the mental destruction I'm heading on. I want to read the things that I read when I first started that everybody was so excited about. Have you been in a situation that the answer for peace in your life was beyond your human ability, your human understanding? A place where it seemed that the dark cloud of depression seemed to hover over you and hopelessness was setting in. Have you been there? Guess what? God gave you the Holy Ghost to help you come through those things. Have you ever been in a situation that your natural talent and abilities could not help? Maybe one of your children was facing something that was beyond your ability to help. Guess what? God's given you the answer to that. God gave you the Holy Ghost to pray through you, the utterances and things that you don't know. You don't know the will of God in the situation. God has given you ability to do that. Have you had a burden for someone that you couldn't figure out exactly what it was or what you would do? Guess what? The Holy Spirit gives you something, a prayer language that you pray for. Have you ever been in a place where you needed direction and it seemed that the human counsel did not bring any peace? Guess what? The Holy Spirit can come along. You may pray in the Holy Ghost on and off all day long, but the Holy Spirit will come along and he'll give you the peace to handle whatever situation you're in. Okay? And we've been praying for people. Thank God we prayed some last Sunday. Some bunch received, some didn't. They went to another place and received it. Hey, but what that's about is creating a hunger. Amen. That's what it's about. You got to fish for something. You got to use the right bait. So all Brother Damon has been trying to teach you the scripture. And again, I ain't trying to force you. I'm trying to figure out now what to do here. I want to pray. If you're here and you want to, yes, ma'am. Did you want to say something? Yes, ma'am. You got to come up here close. I don't have my mic. You can just stand right there. It should pick it up.
Okay. You too. All right. The Holy Spirit put this in me to say something today. I used to be, I grew up in a religious atmosphere, a religious church, where therefore speaking in tongues passed with the disciples. That when I went to different churches, and there was people just mumbling words, you know. I didn't believe in any of that. I didn't believe in anything concerning that. I wanted to know God. I gave my life to Christ at 15. I tried to go do all the religious things, go to church, pay your tithes, do everything that, all the laws. We can't do the laws. If we could, Jesus died in vain. So therefore, I just saw, it sinked in my heart. I needed to know somebody. I didn't want to hear the screaming, the hollering, the huffing, the spot puffing. And I would sit in church for hours and not know what the minister said, other than Jesus, you know. I know how to say Jesus. And I prayed and I talked to God the way I'm talking to y'all. And I went to these churches where it was, oh, Lord, Father, thou God. I can't stand that. I hate religion. Okay, it tore me up, and I was a young kid. It tore me completely up. I remember running and hiding from the minister. If you were the minister, I thought you were better than I was. But I'm just as good as any minister. We're all ministers. We all have the word of God in us when we give our life to Christ. Just like Brother D said. Therefore, when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit come live in you. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead. Jesus didn't start ministering publicly until he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. Then he was led straight up to Satan to be tempted, the same way we are. So once you have a victory,
Look out, Satan coming at you. Just because you're having Satan attack you, he done attacked me in every area. And Brother D and a lot of the people who've been here know that that's true. I've been attacked in every area, all my children, family, husband, all. But I will still stick with God because I know he's not a failure. I'm a victim. I'm victorious, not a victim. Okay, and if he's no respecter of person. I came up here one day before I was divorced. I came up here and I was, God, something bothering me. I prayed. I couldn't wait to get to church so therefore I can hear the word of God. God can speak to me through that. I couldn't read my Bible. I couldn't pray enough. I came up here. It was a late, Brother D wasn't here that day. It was a man came in and he was preaching for him. And I'm like, man, I don't know. This man is not preaching anything I need. And he started talking about speaking in tongues and the gifts of the Spirit. I'm like, God, I need you. Praise and worship weren't working. Nothing wasn't working. But I was there seeking and wanting to know God. Finally, I gave an altar call to come up. And if you wanted to receive the gifts of speaking in tongues. Of course, not me. I don't want to deal with that. I've seen people talk so crazy, you know. So I seen an older guy. Then he came up. I was like, okay, I need this. I need something. So I'm going to sit here and just wait. I'm trying to make a long story short. But I'm going to sit here and wait and let a lot of people come up. Then I'm going to ease up in the crowd. Maybe that'll help. I'm willing to give it a shot. I'm here. So next thing you know, young guy came up. I'm like, okay, I'm waiting on everybody else. Nobody else came. The man's still saying it. And I said, all right, this is it. I thought I looked at my husband at the time, and I said, do you think I should go? And to me, he went, if you want. He said he never said anything to me. All right, but I'm like, okay, I'm sitting here. And finally, okay, I'm finna go. I'll come up here, and I'm in the middle of the night. A man's praying with the younger guy. A man's praying with the older guy. A woman prayed with me. And then another woman and another woman and another woman. I'm looking around like, oh, my God, am I that evil? And these four people? So long story short, I didn't believe in any of this, but this lady started telling me what was going to happen. And I was one guy so bad. And what she was telling me was happening as before she was telling me. She said, you're going to feel butterflies in your, something like butterflies in your stomach. I already felt that. I'm thinking I was just scared or nervous. And then she said, there's something going up. And she was going behind, so I'm looking at her like, how did she know this? You know, but I wouldn't say it. I'm not believing in this. All of a sudden, I don't know, everybody in this church disappeared. I was just me and God. I cannot say that I saw God, but I know that it was like I was in space and there was I've never felt that much love in my life. I would give my life for my children. That was the main thing on my mind. And I didn't want them. I just wanted God. And when I came back, it was like, the church was going crazy. I'm like, what the crap, you know? And the first thing they said, this thing said, just get out of here. That's a cult. This a cult? You better run, you know? Just like he said, a guy told me, I talked to some people. I was so confused, but I'd never been so happy. I was on a four-day high. But everybody told me it was from Satan. Only thing I'm saying is because if you really want all of God, please, it done caught me through for years. It's speaking in tongues doesn't help me. Praying in tongues doesn't help me. So just come. Let somebody pray with you. If it don't happen now, it will.
That's right. Exactly right. All right. If you don't mind, let's just find some music right quick. And it's real simple. If you want somebody to pray for you to release the prayer language you have in your life, it's real simple. You can come down and we'll pray for you. If you don't, we'll close the service out and we'll head in other directions later. Real simple. Just find some music. And if you're there out there, and you want that, and you're a born-again child of God, and you want to be able to pray in the Spirit, have the Holy Spirit come along the side of you, help you, why don't you make your way down? Anybody? Hallelujah. Anybody else? Brandon? This. Anybody else? Hallelujah.